You were caught trying to steal the Shankara stones. There were 5 stones in the beginning. Over the centuries, they were dispersed by wars, sold off by thieves like you.
Thieves like me, huh? Ha! Still missing, too.
A century ago, when the British raided this temple and butchered my people, a loyal priest hid the last 2 stones down here in the catacombs.
So that's what you've got these slaves digging for, huh? They're innocent children.
They dig for the gems to support our cause. They also search for the last 2 stones. Soon we will have all the 5 Shankara stones. And the thuggies will be all powerful.
What a vivid imagination.
You don't believe me? You will, Dr. Jones. You will become a true believer.
Do you expect me to talk?
Welcome to episode 39 of Do You Expect Us to Talk? As always, I'm your host, Becca, and joining me are Chris and Dave. Hi.
Hello.
Good evening, folks.
This week, we are off to Shanghai and then India as we discuss Temple of Doom. As always, the movie stars Harrison Ford, Kate Capshaw, Jonathan Ke Quan, David Yip, and some names I can't pronounce.
David Rick?
David Yip.
She's going to do it again when she gets to the writers, I think.
Oh, dear. Yeah, so also starring Amrish Puri and Dan Aykroyd, if you can spot him in a cameo. This movie written by William Hike.
There you go.
Must stop drinking all that lemonade. Anyway, also written by Gloria Katz, mainly for knowledge of India. Story by George Lucas, directed by Steven Spielberg, and released in 1984. So the movie is as old as me.
Wow.
What do we think of the film?
Dave, do you want to go first? Because I know this is probably the least favourite of the 3 films. I'm only going to refer to them as the 3 films until we get to number 4, but...
Yeah, there's 4 of them, unfortunately.
Oh. Yeah, I mean, this is the first one. Well, it's not the first one I saw, but I saw Raiders one night and walked in to see this the very next day. I was about 7 years old, and at the time, I enjoyed it just fine. And when there were only 2 of them, certainly it could have set up a world where, or a continuity where it was almost in a different style every film. I mean, it starts off with him dressed in a white tux and a sort of very 1930s interpretation almost of James Bond. And then it goes on to something very different to what we got last week. But to the point that you might not have even expected him to end up in his sort of classic outfit if you'd gone in without seeing any marketing. The thing is, though, 4 or 5 years after this, we've got a film much more in the style of the first one, with, you know, Indy fighting the Nazis and a lot of it set outdoors. Crystal Skull, I mean, I don't want to talk about it too much now because, frankly, I've not eaten yet and I don't want to turn my stomach. But it is in some ways more in keeping. The 2 things that make it not in keeping is that there's some very fakey CG in it and Harrison Ford's 20 years older. If they had made an Indiana Jones film in, let's say, 1996 and maybe another one in 2003, Crystal Skull would have looked much more of a piece, regardless of its quality. This film now just stands out like a sore thumb because it's mainly shot on sound stages. It's set largely indoors as a result. It's very slight. It's tonally absolutely all over the place, which we'll get to when we go through it, because it's at once the most juvenile and kiddie and by far the darkest. And I don't have a lot of fun with it anymore. Harrison Ford's really good in it, but you know, it's like having a decent Bond film, but like Stacey Sutton's in every single scene. And that's a bit what it's like. And I've just got real problems with the film now. And it's one that I genuinely think when you watch the original three, if you've got no overriding nostalgia for it or particular interest in the story, you can kind of skip it. And as we get to when we go through it, it's bordering on the racist anyway. So, yeah, I'm not a great lover of this.
I say it's fair dues to Kate Capshaw, really, because obviously, I mean, much with, you know, Stacey Sutton and View to a Kill, yeah, her performance is so memorable because it is so bad. All she does is scream, and the same with Willie here in this film. Literally, she famously criticised her own performance, and she's basically a screaming dumb blonde.
She did what she was asked to do, to be
well,
fair.
Exactly,
we look at some of the Bond girls over the years, and they cast her. She's not even an actress. Well, Kate Capshaw's an actress. She's not the problem. The character is written as the problem.
Yes, exactly. I mean, she does a memorable performance as a really, you know, loathsome character who just basically screams her way through the movie. But it's, you know, kudos to her that she puts in that really memorable performance.
I mean, what I would say before I just hand over to Chris, though, is that if I were to sort of summarise it, you've got a master filmmaker masterfully making a bad film. And I really mean that. The set Steven Spielberg has made better set pieces than you get in the fourth episode. I like some of the films we've discussed in the previous series, less than the sum of its parts. So it's a bad film, exceptionally well made.
I mean, I still have fun with Temple of Doom. I think that to me, that's kind of more what it is. It's more like the enjoyable romp of the indie series. It's very right. It's very tonally different. It's very much more comic booky. I mean, this last week was kind of based much more on a serial saga type thing. It's more of a tribute to that. This is very much more comic book. This is like in tone. It doesn't quite have the hard grittiness. There is some of that there, but you know, when they start like sort of throwing themselves out of a plane using nothing but a rubber ding, you know, it gets a bit okay beyond the realms of reality. But you know what? It's still it still goes along at a steady pace. It's very enjoyable. Willie does not annoy me as much. Though I do understand the criticisms, and I do actually agree, because it did occur to me after watching it recently, she's let down by just a bad script. You know, I think they set Willie up to be, yes, she's annoying, she's selfish, she screams all the time, she's, you know, but I think they set her up to kind of like for her to kind of change and find herself, but the film never really gets to that for her. They just sort of spend, oh well, you know, they really focus more on Short Round a bit more, which is okay, but you know, you need to give Willie something to do.
Well, I think the point is, Chris, I mean, it really hit me today watching it, because I watched it, I think two of the three of us at least have actually watched it today right before recording, and I think you only watched it like, you know, in the last day or two yourself, Chris.
Yeah, I literally just watched it as well.
Huh? Oh, okay, so all three...
To be fair, you have been on holiday. So.
I watched it twice before I went on holiday, and now
I watched it around that time, and I watched it again today, which I don't begrudge doing. It's not a particularly painful experience, but they find, we meet Mola Ram, and we'll get to it, as I say, when we go through the film, but we take just over an hour to meet Mola Ram, and narratively nothing happens in the film after that, really. So there's no room for any redemption of the Willie Scott storyline.
Well, There's a moment that there is a part in it where I generally think, all right, here's what it could have been, but they decided to do something else and make it a bit more of a short round thing.
I'll be interested to get to it.
Oh yeah, I'll save it for when we, you know, go through the film. But yeah, there is a moment I thought, like, you could have done that, or you could have just changed things slightly if you were following through character. And I think it would have made her as a character more satisfying, because, like, I think you're not alone in the character Willie Scott being really, really annoying. But I think actually had that turn, had that kind of like lesson of like, actually, no, I'm gonna have a hero moment. I think, you know,
she is annoying, Chris, but I think some of it is where the series goes afterwards. like I say, if the third Indiana Jones film had featured a completely different type of storyline again, and maybe before we get into the film scene by scene, we'll talk maybe a little bit about the conception of this film, then maybe it would just be where they're playing in different keys each time. But of course, this now stands out very differently. Becca, you really, really loved Raiders. What did you make of this?
Yeah, for a long time, this has probably been... Okay, if you're going to... I'll rank them now. Obviously, this one was always last on the list. It seemed to be replaced by Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. yeah, ages ago, I used to think this was pretty much like the worst of the lot. Obviously, until Crystal Skull came out. It was just tonally all over the place. Like, the Indiana Jones movies have always had the same kind of tone. Obviously, it's meant to be kind of like a boy's own adventure, cliffhanger ending, that sort of style. And this one was just so wildly different. I never really liked it at all. But like watching it this afternoon, I was a little bit like, actually, no, there are enjoyable parts to it. So I've kind of come to it with fresh eyes. I can kind of got a renewed appreciation for it, to be honest.
It's a fun ride. I mean, it's not like the high quality of, say, Raiders or Next Week, which
it's not painful.
Yeah, I mean,
it's not.
As an actual popcorn blockbuster, you know, it fits the bill, you know, and it's like Harrison Ford in Heart and the Whip, you know,
yeah,
you're happy, you know. It's
that's what it says on the tin.
Yeah, face in a new place, facing a new villain, you know, doing his thing, and it's kind of just what you want. I mean, it's got some fun set pieces. It has some very memorable set pieces, actually.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, I think some people maybe prefer Temple of Doom as well. So I think it's probably...
I've heard podcasts from people who do.
Yeah, so...
Yeah, I mean, amongst, like, really... I mean, this has, like, a cult status, isn't it, amongst certainly the core three films. For a lot of people, this is their number one. I can see why. Personally, it's not my favourite. But it's enjoyable nonetheless.
When you look at it as a quartet now, as it is, and we are getting another Indiana Jones film in a while, which will append to this series when we get there. But when you look at it as a quartet, this of the four doesn't feel like an Indiana Jones film across the four. And the fourth one feels like it's doing a weak impression of an Indiana Jones film. And which one I'll struggle with more is actually a bit more up in the air than you might think.
Okay.
We'll get to it.
This film was released in 1984. At the time, George Lucas, who's the producer on this film, and as we go through it, I'll be arguing his fingerprints are much more on it than perhaps Raiders, or certainly the George Lucas we've come to know through the prequels.
Because he's obviously just finished Star Wars, so he probably had more time in his hands to...
Yes. Yeah, to mess around with it.
To meddle, so to speak.
Yeah.
Sounds bad, but yeah.
Yeah. This film... is about 8 to 10 million more expensive than last week's. A lot of that is quite simply Harrison Ford gets an extremely bad injury during the making of this film. We'll talk to it when we get there. So there was a 5-week delay. They shot what they could. An awful lot of the minecart chase and the fight just before it isn't him, and a lot of sort of insert shots afterwards. But it's also they had location issues because India... it demanded final cut and changes to the script and so on, because they said this script is racist. The dinner scene, these are not Indian foods.
No, well, they banned the use of the word Maharaja, didn't they, originally? So
I didn't read that, did they?
Yeah, there's one of the sort of many script changes they wanted to make. And also, I think it was banned in India for a few years, obviously, now that's been lifted. But...
About the dinner scene. When was Octopussy? I know it's your favourite Bond film, Dave.
Previous year. Octopussy's 83. This is 84.
So Octopussy did something similar with the dinner scene, with in terms of like eating the eyeball kind of thing. Do you think that possibly inspired it somewhat, and they just kind of went out all
No mention of Bond in this. I mean, we know Spielberg at least is interested in the Bond series. I just think it's a couple of filmmakers who, in the nicest possible way, haven't really grown up. So they had to do this dinner scene. They're like, wouldn't it be amazing if they're all eating gross things? And it's a little bit childish, really. And it's I have this problem sometimes in the horror genre that, instead of being scared, I'll just sit there watching it and going, oh, fucking grow up. You know? But yeah, so it was a vastly more expensive film, or significantly more expensive, but we're still not talking Empire Strikes Back's Return of the Jedi level of budget. It's still trying to do it relatively cheaply and old school. 80% of it is shot on sound stages, which is a notable departure from the previous film. And when I think of Last Crusade, I think of them outside on the bike and all that sort of thing. So it looks a very different film. But the other thing to note about it is two things. Firstly, Spielberg and Lucas were both going through painful breakups in their personal lives. Lucas was divorcing or being divorced by Marcia Lucas, his then wife. She was the editor on the original Star Wars film and is credited in many quarters with saving that film in the edit. So he was not in the best of moods, and Spielberg was going through a painful breakup with Amy Irving, who's probably known best for her role in the original Carrie film, the 1976 film. Although they did get back together and marry the next year, which led to one of the most expensive divorces in Hollywood history about 4 years afterwards. So they weren't in a good place, and so that accounts for the darkness of the film. The other thing we need to bear in mind is, a year after Raiders, not only was he hot off doing Raiders, but Steven Spielberg released E.T., which was the biggest film ever made at that time. So there is some evidence that they were rushing to get this film written before they lost Spielberg to some other project, because he was in, not a specific project, but in general, we've got to get him locked down now.
Well, he gets too big for his boots, kind of thing.
Yeah, Lawrence Kasdan wanted nothing to do with it, because once he started talking story outlines with them, he said that they were mean and too dark, and he wanted nothing to do with the way this film was going. So he got in the two writers Becca mentioned at the outset of the show, who, you know, wrote things like the Radioland murders. Their filmography isn't as strong. But that's how we end up with Temple of Doom in 1984. It was a deliberate attempt to distance itself from the previous film. It's set as a prequel because it's set the year before Raiders of the Lost Ark. That's for two reasons.
Understood that. I was like, well, what was the point?
Two reasons that I understand. Bear in mind, the first film set in 1936. The world politically is hotting up around then. How do you go forward in time 2 or 3 years and not tell another story about the Nazis? We're set 3 years on from Raiders. I mean, if you went 3 years on from 1936, you've got the breakout of World War II. So a prequel was partly, I've heard this on special features and so on, to avoid using the Nazis again. The second reason, as I understand it, is that the argument was Indy wouldn't leave Marion. So if you want a different girl, it's got to be set before.
Yeah. I suppose that's... I'm not sure if it's intentionally, but it feels very much like this isn't like Willie's not like the love of his life. It very much just feels like
she's struggling to be the love of his week.
Yeah, it's like, and it's not like in a bad way. It's like they're both like know exactly what it is. I think it's just like they're just having a bit of like a kinky fun, really. You know, just like
kinky fun.
I tell you what, we'll go to a cursed temple and fuck.
There'll be bugs and shit. It'll be awesome.
Yeah, it is a very, very different film right from the outset. It's got the feeling more to me of like a caper, in that, you know, they end up where they end up through happenstance, and this adventure unfolds to them. He kisses the girl at the end of it. Cue credits. That's it. It's a lot more disposable, not just because of its quality, but it just feels more disposable than Raiders.
They're all kind of standalone films, but this feels a bit more of like, in my head, because I think strangely, so forgive me, listeners, I do think like a little bit kind of like off kilter, but this kind of feels like if this was like a TV show, this feels like more like as a regular one-off episode, as opposed to like sort of like the regular the regular continuous episode you have that would be connected to everyone, everything else would be more Nazi related. I would have thought it's that kind of thing. I got from this, but this felt very much like a one off. It's like one and done kind of like entry rather than like a continuation of the Indiana Jones story. It's rather like, hey, well, here's another adventure kind of thing. So, if that makes any sense, I don't know. But...
It's Goldfinger between From Russia With Love and Thunderbolt. You know, yeah. In that, like, he takes on the Nazis, sort of. I mean, Belloc isn't quite sympathetic to the Nazis.
No.
And Last Crusade's kind of almost like a rematch. You know?
He actually gets to meet Hitler, doesn't he, pretty much?
And the two go together. It's Mr. Bronson to you, Becca.
Mr. Bronson to you, yes. Mr. Bronson.
Yes, that seems to have some respect for the Führer.
Mr. Bronson to you.
After what he did to Danny Kendall. So, shall we discuss this film sequentially?
Yeah, why not?
Oh. No, let's not do that. Let's do something else.
Okay, right.
So, four-fifths of the way through the film.
Let's start at the beginning. So, Indy gets the girl.
No, so again, this is like another thing of, this film kind of starts off really oddly. It's not in the way you expect. It starts off with a random musical number. I can imagine people walking in after watching Raiders, really, really enjoying it. Oh, great, it's a sequel. I can imagine they're sitting in the cinema in 1984, thinking, right, great, new Indiana Jones film. It starts, and it's like a minute into it, you're thinking, is this the right film? Have they put the right
walk
thing
out
in?
And check the number of the screen you've walked into. I'm sure it said screen one.
Yeah. Like, is this right? Has there been some sort of mistake? Have they got the right reel?
obviously, we didn't have the internet back then, or certainly not in its modern form. But I do remember pre-internet, and we did still see reviews, and we did still see commercials for things. So I think, in reality, this wouldn't have happened. But I do wonder, this film is quite well set up that if you go in having seen no press and promotion for it, you just know that the next film in the series has come out. Whether you'd remember that the previous one was 1936, I don't know. So whether you'd even twig this as a prequel, because I didn't for quite a while. And then he sits down in a white tux. And you think, well, it's kind of a period Bond film. With a little bit of, I don't know, Charlie Chan or something thrown in. And it starts with this musical number, which I believe is Lucas's idea. It just feels so different. I like it a lot. I mean, the Paramount logo, instead of transitioning to a mountain, it transitions to like a big gong in this like restaurant stroke cabaret bar.
You've got like the film title in that classic like Indiana Jones typeface as well, haven't you? Like for the
And she stood through it as well. Yeah. She actually obscured some of it. I have to say, and this will be really controversial, this is my favourite opening of any of the Indiana Jones films.
No, it's understandable because it is really, really good. It's really majestic and kind of it. Even though it's random, I think I understand because I know you like films that take risks, and this does take a risk of like let's just be completely different. And
I don't demand risks, but I respect having a go. Yeah.
And I just think it was. I think Lucas and Spielberg were probably thinking right. This one's going to be a lot more adventurous, a bit more of a fun kind of romp. And I reckon they just like, no, I've always wanted to do a musical number. Should we open with a musical number? Yeah, why the fuck not? I think that's basically what they did.
It's everything about it, though, because it looks beautiful. Yeah. It looks really classy. And the interplay at the song goes into almost like a dream sequence element to it, which has got all the sparkles in the floor and the wall that actually... at once makes it look like there's a bit of grain or something on the film, so it looks old, but it looks classy at the same time. And then the scene that follows it is fantastic. What did you think, Becca?
Well, yeah, it's an amazing tribute to those kind of like RKO classic musicals of like the 30s and 40s, isn't it, really? So, I quite like it, actually. I think, well, it's amazing for Capshaw to learn, was it Chinese, like Mandarin, I suspect, because really a difficult language to learn, and imagine, you know, let alone to sing...
We had a listener request, didn't we, for Chris to do the song in Mandarin?
Yes, we did.
we had a listener request because our listeners also believe you have the voice of an angel.
or maybe just like torture. Maybe.
Yeah, so Kate Capshaw learnt this and sang it in Mandarin. The only thing that's missing that was planned was she was supposed to tap dance in this more, but the dress is just too restrictive around her leg. She couldn't.
very glamorous costumes, though. One thing I will say about this film, every costume is amazing, especially the dresses that she wears. I mean, fair enough, they kind of end up ruined at the end. I think one of them was eaten by an elephant or something like that.
they had to repair glamorous. It because this was shot last.
Yeah.
So you see it hanging over a tree and the elephant eats it. And I was only reading today, it's on Wikipedia, you can all go and find this. When they were talking, I didn't get all my information from Wikipedia, but I did read the page just before we recorded. The elephant, that was a one-off dress, so they claimed for it on insurance, and they had no choice to write the cause of the damage as dress eaten by elephant.
By elephant.
So they had to fix it for this dance scene.
Oh dear. I like the fact that the elephants. Oh dear, no, they're very lovely. The club's called. No, they don't. Surprisingly enough,
I'm never cute. Eating that again.
I like that it's called Obi-Wan Club too.
Yeah, there's a reference to Star Wars. There's another reference to Star Wars in the Raiders as well. There was like R2 and
R2. I think it's where they go to pick the Ark up from the Well of Souls. Mm-hmm. It's in the sort of hieroglyphics on the wall.
Yeah, I've always missed
it. I've seen photos of it. You can search it. If you've never noticed it, you can search it and call up an image search of it. But I've certainly never noticed it whilst watching the film.
Yeah. I think it's probably just blinky and miss it kind of thing.
And then you know where to look for it.
It's very Bondian, but I kind of like it. It's very fun, very kind of, with the deal with the poison and the antidote and all that kind of stuff. Why Indy's bothered by a diamond, I don't know, but who cares, quite frankly.
It's just the way they're going to pay him for this item. And they use that circular thing you sort of see in some Chinese restaurants.
Is it Lazy Susan? Is that what it's called?
I don't know what they're called, but the centre bit of glass on a table that you can move food around to each other when you're sat around a circular table. And it's a small and obvious detail, but they could have just sat at a regular table and done that, and it wouldn't have been the same.
No.
It makes it more tense, though, I think, doesn't it? So.
Well, the shifting of the table goes in time with moving the camera back and forth between them.
It does.
And we believe Willie Scott is sort of set up as Lao Che, he's called Mistress, I think, because Indy grabs her and sort of sticks like a fork in her side.
She's her, really. Done.
Yeah. I wish I had been. But it's great. Basically, he's gone there to give an item to Lao Che in
he's returning the ashes of the founding emperor of whatever that he's associated
with. Yeah, the first dynasties of China.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Lao Che basically gives him the diamond, but then has poisoned him.
Yeah.
So they toast it with a glass of champagne, and then they all start giggling. And I love that. I just love the way he says, "And now you give me the diamonds."
He's like, never.
What's that? It's the antidote to the poison you just
struck. The poison you just struck.
It is fiendishly evil. Would know. And he's such a bastard, he doesn't even do it. He just continues laughing. He's like, whatever.
No, he is like movie villain, you know.
And
Harrison Ford is feeling the effects before he knows he's feeling the effects. Yeah. And that he starts grabbing at his collar, and he's like, he's starting to sweat, but he doesn't know anything's wrong yet. It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
It's good. I think he does give a good performance in this movie, I think, so.
It's he's really good at comedic sort of bumbling around while being physically fighting. He's very good at doing that. But what also plays about this scene is, don't you just want to see the villains come back? Like, I've always felt like, oh no, but I want to see them come back in another film. I want to see Indy fit,
You could have set up quite a universe when you think about it. Not a universe, it would still be all based around Indy. Yeah. But if you'd knocked out five or six of these films, let's say, in a much more truncated time frame than we're going to get, he could have had villains in different parts of the world that sort of dipped in and out of different stories.
Yeah. Had it gone a bit more Bondy, and there's loads of these. You could have built more of that, really, couldn't you?
It could have been his rogues gallery.
Yeah.
Yeah, it really could have.
Yeah. I quite like that idea. I never thought of it before. Brilliant.
Yeah, I know. I just always wanted to see them return because they're in this, one scene in the entire franchise of the Indy series. And I just, I was like, oh, but they're so fiendishly devious and evil. I kind of want to see them get their comeuppance. I want to see him come back for in another film and Indy get his, like, you know, fight him again.
His revenge against them.
Yeah, because it's, I suppose it's like, it's probably better that they just have this time, because they are really memorable as well. I think it's testament to the actors and the scene itself, just how memorable they are in that short space of time that they have.
Yeah, it's a shame that we don't see them again.
Yeah, well, yeah, exactly. That's how I feel, really. I would have been nice had they say as Last Crusade opened, it would have like, and it's another scene involving them. You know,
they could have been a pre-title in another film.
Yeah,
it
could have been like a pre-title villains site, yeah. Essentially. It's a shame, but hey, I really like the scene. And any scene that gets away with punching a random woman in the face, I'm in.
The dialogue is very B movie, and you forgive it because of what this series is. So last week we've got Belloc saying, "We're not so different, you and I." And when somebody says that to James Bond, well, I'm fucking furious, but I was absolutely fine with it in that context. And of course, David Yip's character gets shot. As champagne corks are going off, and he's like, he just come over with a glass of wanked off, not fingered for him. And first known appearance of that drink. And as he gets shot,
isn't
he's
the
like,
same guy in the View to a Kill? Forgive me for...
Yes, he is.
Down at
the wharf, yeah.
Yeah.
The Chinese detective, that's one.
Yeah, and of course, that kicks off a huge fight, and the scene's not as good after
CIA.
That. Yeah. As soon as the mayhem starts, I'm less interested.
Yeah, it's
a bit fun. It does disintegrate quite quickly.
But I like the Tommy gun. I like any excuse for like the guy just going mental with a Tommy gun, just like laughing manically. I thought that's just bright. And Indy sort of using that old big steel drum just had to that rock that's rolling along like sort of, that's catching all the bullets. It's just great. I love it.
Yeah, so basically they escape together.
Yeah.
They escape together with the antidote, and he lands in a car that's basically being driven by what is a 10-year-old?
Data John.
What's
my short round impression?
What's your feelings on short round? What's your feelings on children being in films in general? Like, as like the comedic sidekick. This is the problem with this film. It has like two comedic sidekicks.
It's too much in this film.
Yeah.
And they don't know where to put the lines half the time. I do remember when I first saw this film, and he's driving the car with these big blocks on his feet so he can reach the pedals. I was 7. That was impossibly cool at the time. So I didn't mind it, but I think kids would like this because I did. But the film's so tonally confused, you can't really argue it's aimed at kids. So not specifically or exclusively anyway. As kid actors go, he's not too bad. I mean, he's not overly irritating. It's fine. But I just think this is George Lucas's fingerprints all over it. That George Lucas, and I must stress in a completely non-sexual way, almost fetishizes children in films now. It's like he's just got to cram some fucking little moppet in his films. And it gets on my tits. And it's like, this is not right for the Indiana Jones character. You know, it just isn't right. It doesn't play right at all. And, you know,
well,
he's kind of in the way half the time. He's not bad. The guy they've cast or the kid they've cast does fine. That it's not ruinous to the film. But, yeah, I kind of wish he wasn't here.
What always gets me about this, particularly since this is a prequel, and they do have this, like, old development of, like, of... Short Round's like Indy's best friend, but yet he's not mentioned, seen, or heard of in any of the other films. So I wonder what the fuck's happened to Short Round if he's such a great fucking friend, such a great companion for Indiana Jones. Like, where the fuck is he?
Least of my problems is him encountering this boy, because he's all over the world, he's going to different places, some of them in great poverty. I could see how he might end up with a child kept under his wing. But not sat outside ready to drive the car. It just... You've got to accept what it is. I mean, realism is not this series' strong suit anyway. But again, it's just very George Lucas that he does it with Star Wars. It's like, well, it's for kids. Well, why are we talking about fucking tax then? You know, it's the same here. It's like, it's for kids. All right. Well, I'm sure they love that guy's heart being ripped out. You know,
yeah, it's quite gory, isn't it?
Work out what you're doing, you know, and I just think a kid doesn't really belong in this film, other than there are children in the film, and I suppose it might be with half an eye to that.
Yeah, it's kind of a way in for that, really. I think they should have picked one. They should have had, like, the character of Willie Scott or Short Round, not both. I mean,
but not if he's going to, like, snob one at the end.
Well, obviously not.
I was hoping there'd be a woman here, but you'll have to do.
Obviously not. No, that wasn't my point. No.
I was pitching the very last scene where Short Round thinks, oh, well, everything's done, I'm just walking off, and there comes the whip around his waist. It's like, Dr. Jones, what are you doing?
Look, I'm not into this. I'm not into kids, but, like, it's the end of the adventure. I'll fucking stop somebody.
That really wasn't my intention.
Oh, anyway. Where were we? Yeah, so he's in the kid's taxi. And there's it is like a bit of a relentless chase. We start off of action. Yeah. So we get a chase with a kid when it's like quite comedic, but yeah, we're still having, you know, shooting guns. And he loses his gun because Willie Scott's a fucking idiot. But then
it's like, I bet my fingers are broken nail. It's like, shut up.
But yeah, I guess it's like, it's nice. It's like the fact that, oh, he's lost his gun, so he's it's one of his superpowers, I guess. It's not quite the same impact of losing
superpowers.
Well, but it's one of his things. He's got a gun and a whip. That's his thing, isn't it?
Sure.
It would be more impactful if he lost his whip, to be honest with you. But then again, why would he be using his whip in a car chase? I do love the reveal when you get to the airplane strip and Dan Aykroyd's there, and he thinks he's got away, and the door closes, and you see like Lee Chow there.
His last words are, you know, a nice try, Lao Che.
Lao
and then
Che.
He closes the door and
Lao Che Airlines.
Which I like.
Yeah.
It's good.
It's good sort of, you last see those villains cackling away again, it's like, oh.
If you had any doubt that he was going to sort of end up back in the costume we know, it gets, that fear gets abated here. He actually does end up back in his outfit. And he's got Willie with him starting already to moan, whine and shout constantly.
Well, she's basically just been too pampered all her life, really. She's that kind of character, so she would be kind of... She doesn't quite grasp what is going on. She's been kind of sheltered her whole life, really. She's just like, all she knows is, like, singing and being treated and having a high life,
going
really.
Going to parties and...
Yeah,
mingling
so...
Mingling rich people.
Yeah, exactly. So she's from that world, so I felt like the film kind of failed her character, because I thought the idea of introducing someone like that to the world of Indy was to kind of like, well, I will show you there's more to life than...
You know, nails.
Yeah. Essentially be your pampered lifestyle and for her to actually grow more.
She's like
the only
sort of like woman in that universe that doesn't want to... She's unwilling to go on the adventure with him, really. So she's... I mean, it's quite different. It's quite refreshing in that aspect. But like, compared to somebody like Marion, for example, she doesn't want to go on the adventure. She's like, no, I hate nature. You know, she's like, when you go into the jungle, she's like, it's crawling with nature. And it's just like, well, what do you expect, you know? And she just doesn't want to be there. And it's completely different.
I mean, I do think there's chemistry between the two, you know. They do have a good back and forth.
Well, I have to say, Harrison Ford has chemistry with everybody. I just think he's one of those actors. We talked about it during our last series that, like, Brosnan, for all his charisma as a man, didn't have a lot of chemistry with a lot of the actors and actresses paired with him. Harrison Ford plays really well off everybody at this stage of his career.
Yeah,
he does.
He's just got that sort of, that sort of charming, kind of rugged, you know. Well, he's Han Solo, essentially, isn't he? So of course he is. But yeah, no, I've always kind of enjoyed the back and forth between him and Willie. Even though I know Willie annoys everyone, which I understand. But
Willie back and forth.
God.
I was gonna laugh, and it was gonna be audible. So I just thought I might as well just fucking own it. Tee hee, Willie, back and forth.
Get out of your system now. We're gonna hear a lot of it.
I'm not getting anything out of my system now. I've only just polished this microphone. It's the only thing I've polished today, though, I promise.
Oh, dear.
So, anyway.
Anyway.
The plane's about to crash, and again, that's not a euphemism. We're back on the plot now.
Yeah, essentially the pilots have, like, just parachuted out of the plane, leaving them with no parachutes. And, they basically try to escape. Well, they escape using a rubber dinghy.
Which is quite an incredible... I mean, I'd like to know this. I'd love to have seen the script conference where they had a chat about that. Because all of the plots for these films and scripts and all the rest of it were sort of broken around tables with people discussing it. So somebody would have had to go, bear with me here, and float this as an idea.
On a dinghy.
I think they put it more as a spectacle, because when I watched the film, the idea of seeing people on a rubber dinghy, of them actually free falling and landing on the on a hillside of the snow, which would kill them. But, you know, okay. But I would have thought that they would have written it so that the plane kind of just about goes on the edge of a mountain. They just jump at that brief short part and start sliding down the hill, you know, before the plane crashes. So yeah. I would have thought that would be more logical. You know, it's like they'll try and steer the plane towards the ground a bit more and then just jump out last minute. But
yeah,
I would have thought that'd be more logical and more. Kind of like, yeah, well, that makes sense.
I've never hated it, though. I mean, it's one of the things that gets slaughtered a bit, like with Crystal Skull, with the three waterfalls.
Yeah, it's no nuclear bomb in a fridge, is it, really?
No, it's okay. It's not okay, but it's okay. I think it's a bit of a silly idea. I don't think it's that well done, but the film is still whipping it along at quite a pace.
Yeah,
I mean, you've had a moment of him laying down on the plane, and you've had a moment where she wakes him up. But that's about it. The film has been in perpetual motion since David Yip's character was shot, basically, and that's several minutes before this. So I don't really have a problem with it. The pacing of the film goes awry quite quickly after this, but at this point, I'm fine with it.
Yeah, so they end up on a river. They fall off waterfalls as well.
They do waterfall.
Yeah.
Okay.
Am I thinking of Crystal Skull?
I don't know. That's what's confused me. I watched it an hour or so ago. I forgot.
They go sort of obviously out of the air into whitewater rafting, well, into snow, and then whitewater rafting. Then they think they go over the edge of the waterfall. And
That's a
massive callback to that one.
Yeah.
No, that's
what
it,
a
yeah.
day we've had.
Oh, very busy.
Then they came out of platoon laughing.
Platoon. It's a miracle how they survived.
And then they had a hot dog at a ball game.
And then you're going to get fish and chips. But it's amazing how they survive it. It really is.
Yeah.
Crystal Skull's obviously a callback to it, isn't it? So.
Yeah. Well, I imagine it was probably more to do... Actually, I think I figured out why they decided to go for the free fall of the rubber dinghy. Well, it was something about the tribe in... I don't know what you would call it. Would you call it a tribe? Is that the PC term we would say? I don't know.
Let's just go with it for now. Apologies, folks, if that is the wrong term, but we're going to go with a tribe.
Yeah. They prophesize heroes that will fall from the sky and save and right the wrongs that, you know, save their children, etc., and retrieve the stone. So I think the idea that they saw that and they saw, oh, look, there's the chosen one. They're the prophesied ones.
So therefore
they're waiting for him, literally they're drifting on shore, fucked. They're like, oh
yeah, although later he's told all their water's turned to sand, and I'm thinking, well, the bit you floated in on was all right. So they meet a guy who the actor couldn't speak English at all. There's gaps in his speech where Spielberg is saying it to him so he can repeat it and doing the actions and everything. That actor had no idea what he was saying.
Yeah, it's not like dramatic pauses, but just literally he's waiting for his next line.
Yeah, it works fine, actually, I think. Because you understand that you'd buy the fact that it wouldn't be his first language, obviously. So,
oh, yeah.
Living but where he is. You're fortunate that he speaks it at all, quite frankly. Yeah. So, yeah, would it would it wouldn't be, you know, it's realistic for it to be a little bit stretchy, but, you know, it works fine. I really like, I guess what one of the scenes were like, in terms of when they were having the food, with Willie, and...
Oh, that's awful, so embarrassing.
I'm food with Willie out. No, but just with, like, showing just how, like, she doesn't quite get her situation with the with her, like, you're insulting them and you're embarrassing me. Like, that kind of...
And I love the way he plays that, but I just don't know. We already know she's spoiled. She's not the outdoors type. We already know this. And I just think to throw in her being so rude to a tribe that are clearly starving, I think is over-egging it a bit, because Willie really loses me from here on. Yeah. She's really like, oh, no, this is too much.
I guess because after you just had like a load of action scenes, which would basically mean Willie screaming a lot, you're like, oh, okay, come off it.
We've just learned all this about the character.
Yeah.
We didn't know, but I would expect most people in that scenario, if that scenario could ever, arise, to understand that you are being given resources as a welcome from a very meagre pool of resources and be fucking grateful.
You see, I don't think she would at that point. You know, I see that she's still in, like, I can't believe all this shit is happening to me mode. So she isn't, like, kind of thinking beyond herself at this point. She's just like, oh, just want to get back to civilization, really. That's all she's got on her mind.
And I get the impression that she's obviously not as well travelled as Indy, but, you know, she has a life in Shanghai, you would imagine that she doesn't actually mix with the locals. There's maybe some kind of expat community that she hangs around with, you know, all the military people who happen to be there, you know, all their rich wives, things like that. But it's perhaps kind of more well, apparently into there, I guess.
She's world famous, apparently. But,
apparently, but still, even though, you know.
But I'm not sure how famous you would be by, you know, singing in... in Chinese,
no.
I mean, I know the world was a different place back in that times, but you know, I'm not sure quite. But anyway,
it's not Shea Stadium, is it?
No.
But they're sent off. They're basically, their crops have failed. Their kids have been kidnapped. They're starving, and they believe it's to do with this stone that's gone missing.
Yeah, this makes me. It's meant to be some sort of magical stone, and you know, it's this is like different to what the arc was. I mean, next week we get the Holy Grail essentially, and you know, those are both like well, like known kind of myths or documented.
It adds into the idea that this is just another episode,
yeah,
because it's far, far lower stakes, not for the people of that community, obviously, because they've lost their children, but we've got the stakes of if the Fuhrer gets hold of this supernatural being, and in the third one, we've got potentially eternal life.
Hmm.
And it's only at the end we find out that you can't pass a certain point with it. For large portions of this film, if you're not if you're not familiar with it, we could be talking at an ever living Third Reich, effectively. So this is much, much smaller stakes. And when they introduce the Ark of the Covenant in the first film, it would ring a bell in the back of your head somewhere. Same with the Holy Grail. In this, we almost certainly would never have heard of this artifact.
Yeah, it's just like, oh,
if indeed it's real.
It's a magical stone, or it's like part of like low stone. I mean, I do think there is some attempt to raise the stakes, because I think the whole idea of them kind of hypnotizing people with the blood, there was like talk of like trying to rule the world with it, kind of thing of like that danger of them sort of gaining more power and growing beyond where they are. How realistic and how well played out that is, you know. Down to you, listeners, but you know, I think that I remember there was something there, but yeah, you're right. It is a bit more of a personal kind of journey. I mean, I feel like Indy in this one, Rav is doing it more not out of like duty, not the idea of like, oh, I'm gonna need to bring this random stone back to the museum. I never had thought he was going there for that. He was up. I think he was more of a. he's been asked to do something, and he sees like a group of people who've been wronged, and he can't turn his back away from that. And that's essentially what it is. It's just like, you know, I've seen like sort of atrocity been put in, and I have to do something about it. They've asked me to help. I have to go and help. You know. And that's how I see it. Not rather than like he's just after to find like an artifact like he normally is.
Now, what shocked me watching it today, less so even last week, I think I was just paying more attention today, is actually how little plot there is in this film after this point. Basically from here on, and we'll go back to talking through the film scene by scene, but when you think about it, they go to the temple, they have a disgusting meal, Indy and Willie Scott nearly have a shag, and then they find their way downstairs, find out this thing's going on, and then it's action, done.
Well, they get caught. Not,
this film
like
is unbelievably fucking thin.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a problem with that, though. I mean, for what it is, like, a bit more...
It's fine as a one-off. I think it's just what surrounds it.
Yeah. Which, yeah, I think it's absolutely, you know... I mean, okay, it could be better in places, but I think this play plays a bit more to kids in a weird way. I know people call this like the like really dark, and it does have darker stuff in it, but ultimately
also by far the kiddiest.
Yeah, the whole tone of it is lighter. The whole tone is very much more comic book. You know, I mean, you got one of the good guys is essentially a kid, so that's going to make it more kid friendly anyway. It just feels very much more light, and the whole style of it is more comedic than the other two. So, but you know, I don't mind like having like a blockbuster films that is just pure, just like set piece. I mean, I think some of it is great. I mean, yeah, you're right. There is basically just like they go across like a jungle, and then they walk into the palace. They have a meeting with the king,
he was prime minister and the Maharaja. Yeah,
yeah. Which, you know, there's only sort of obviously you can tell they can only on certain budgets. You know, they show like certain parts of the place anyway.
Well, there's a lot of map paintings in this, but yeah. Again, it's late change of location. But you've got they set off on elephants. And I find this section of the film really fucking ponderous. I know it's supposed to be funny, Indy being caught cheating at cards and her struggling in the wild and snakes and all the rest of it, but it seems to go on way too long. They're clearly sat on sound stages. Again, it's a big flaw of this film. And then they get to the temple, but it's lost a lot of momentum.
I think it's a chance for them to explain explain the plot, really, because, you know, like... It, you know, Indy's there, basically explaining like what's happened. You know,
but look how Raiders was able to do that. Raiders was able to basically get across the bits we don't know about the arc through how he got the assignment, and as things unfold in the plot, we're told a little bit more. Here, it has to be done in a big data dump because it's something we've never heard of, and this film hasn't stopped moving in the first 10 minutes or so.
Yeah, I think that's, well, yeah, I think they're just two very different films. I think it goes down to like the style of what it is. I mean, I'm not going to argue against, you know, why this film is better than Raiders, because that's just idiotic. But if this is like meant to be a bit more like, I mean, I'm not even sure Spielberg knew what exactly they were going to do third one even anyway. I mean, they could just like. Sure do.
No, they didn't have the three worked out. They always had to do. Lucas kind of claimed they did, but they didn't.
So maybe, I mean, like, even with the third film, I talk about doing like a haunted house film, which just sounds fucking crazy.
They were for this. This actually sort of, it was talked about for this as well.
Yeah. So I don't know how that would have worked out, but obviously they'll probably playing around with ideas, so maybe having like each film completely different in tone and style or whatever. So there could have been that kind of thing going on.
I think what makes it worse for me, Chris, is simply that the start was so good.
Yeah.
It's Spy Who Loved Me syndrome. It's like, oh, you hit such a high at the start of this. I believe, and only I believe, I think, I don't think it's a commonly held view, but I think you even outdid Raiders in your first 10 minutes. And then it goes quite ponderous for quite a while. And the film really doesn't have that much to it afterwards.
No, in terms of plot, no, it doesn't. It doesn't.
Becca?
This kind of journey, I mean, this is the part, there's this section before they actually get to the temple itself, and then there's a few sections just before, prior to the minecart chase, that I do think drag. And it's been done better, as you said just now, they did it much easier in the previous film. So I don't know, obviously they've got different writers, mainly picked for, they have a good filmography, but these writers, they're kind of known for their knowledge of India, rather than, I don't know, their output, I guess. But that's no disrespect to them. But yeah, it drags purely for that reason, really, and they've done it so much better in the previous film, so I don't know why they can't do it here. But yeah, I just, you know, agree with both of you, really. It's kind of my least favourite part of the film.
Well, it's the part that you kind of zone out and wait for the, like, the freaky stuff.
Wait for the good part.
Yeah.
So we go straight on to Pankok Palace, then, where he's met by... And I never quite knew who he was. I actually looked it up. He's like the Prime Minister, basically. And they're taken for this meal, which I just think is like a film written by a couple of six-year-olds.
Snake, you know, surprise. What I mean?
It's just like, and then they eat snakes, and then it's monkey brains, and then, you know.
Yeah, so they're written by, like,
brains.
Chilled monkey brains, yeah. Like 10-year-old boys.
Like all the soup and all that stuff.
I just think, like, it's a film that's loosely stringing together set pieces. And we do hear in the making of this film, well, that set piece there was supposed to be, was first talked about for that film instead. And they've loosely pieced it together. This scene is there for no real reason other than to nauseate Willie Scott, really, and basically insult that culture.
It's literally like you see him making, going like, oh, okay, well, this is like what Kate Capshaw's doing is gold with this, like, kind of the whole whining and moaning thing. So let's give her like a load of stuff to whine and moan about, yeah. While Indy has like another little sort of debate. We can talk a bit more about a plot somewhat.
Also, he's borrowed the Bond producer's wardrobe in that, like, in all of that, he managed to, like, take his tweed with him. Because he's dressed in his, like, suit after.
His mysterious travelling wardrobe again.
Reminded me of Fit Inspector, where it's like, put another suit on. He's got a wee... It's like Narnia in that case. But it's... but, yeah, the scene where they were heading to the palace on the elephants... Harrison Ford said that's where he started having problems with his back, because you basically, and I may have misremembered this, but you basically sit on the elephant's shoulder blades, and the way you have to sit was straining his back. Then, when you come out of this scene and you have this sort of byplay between him and Willie, where they look like they might be about to, like, have sex, they're in rooms opposite each other, and it's meant to be a bit screwball comedy.
I thought that was really funny, actually. I quite like that scene. It's kind of like, well, he's not coming, she's not coming. 5 minutes, and it's just like 4.5 minutes. I thought it was quite funny.
I quite like that scene too, but it's where Harrison Ford is attacked. There's like a bit of a somersault in it. Harrison Ford got a herniated disc off that.
Ouch.
And it put him out of action. And they were saying he tried to carry on. I mean, he could barely walk, if at all. And yet he was still sort of getting to the set and trying to make it work. And eventually they had to send him back to the US, because this is largely filmed at Elstree Studios in Britain again. And they sent him back to the United States for surgery. So he was away for 5 weeks. And they shot what they could with Vic Armstrong, which is why a lot of the time where he's fighting Mola Ram and things like that, you're not seeing his face because it's not him.
Oh, right, okay.
But he got a severe injury. He does suffer for his art. I mean, he had his knee run over in the last film. When we get to Star Wars down the line, he gets a broken leg in The Force Awakens, and he gets a severe herniated disc here, which required surgery.
And he survived a plane crash as well, not so long ago as well.
That was during The Force Awakens, yeah. Too. Survived a plane crash, yeah. So this was a tough shoot. You've got a director and a producer who just don't want to be there. When you watch the special features, you can see Steven Spielberg's got a bit of a crush on Kate Capshaw. I'm not implying anything, because I don't know what did or didn't happen when, but there's a fondness between them. You can see it.
All right.
But it's a tough set, and they say their leading man gets a severe injury.
I mean, about that fight, though, I do like the reveal of, like, the guy just standing there. Because it's really cleverly done. Like, you know, and you see it now, it's like, there he is, but he's standing so still. You watch it for the first time, you would never know in a million years, and he'd just pop out and start strangling it. But the fight itself is pretty mediocre, but the reveal, I think, is pretty great. But yeah, so we have the fight, and then he goes into Willie's room, and I like this kind of thing because she's still unaware of like basically what's going on. He's just like on lookout mode for her, like secret passages, and she's like, "I'm here," like that's pretty funny. He's there like pushing the boobs on the statue, and she's like, "Yeah." So basically, they go down and like to the through secret passageway, which is like. Unrealistically surrounded by bugs and insects, which is a bit like
okay. Again, it's the childlike mentality in the makers of this film, and I'm not going to knock Spielberg. I think Spielberg's might even be the greatest living filmmaker we have. I mean, the amount he's done in different genres and stuff. But obviously, you've got the snakes in the first film, you've got the rats next week, and it just seems like what do we have this week? It is almost sort of laying down a bit of a formula.
Yeah, snake. It's snakes, bugs, rats.
I don't know what it's meant to be doing for us, because I don't find it particularly tense. I find Willie quite annoying with it, and it's just this feeling they're loosely connecting bits, and this is the bug bit.
Yeah, so the bug section. But I think each film, they kind of try to up the stakes of like the gross-out factor. I think this film probably has it all, so you've got the most bugs and insects, most creepy crawlies. One of my fun facts is how many creepy crawlies they used, but I'll tell you that later on. And also you've got the chilled monkey brains. Kill, though?
Hang on a minute. We're not going to get excited about it now, but that means there's some fun facts. Later fun on, facts, there's going to be some fun facts.
As always, that is our formula. That doesn't sound fun. That sounds dirty.
I think Dave just came.
No.
Dave, do you need a wet wipe?
Nah, I'll just let it dry.
Have a tissue.
Anyway, carry on.
Okay. So, yeah, I mean, I do kind of like the scene, even though it is kind of like... What's the thing with the whole crusher? Why do you need spikes? Surely that would be like a hindrance.
But again, that sort of betrays its serial origins. I said last week that we'd see a little bit more of this sort of B-movie pulpy origins in this film, and certainly the dinner scene's got that. The episodic structure, and now it's, you know, this ceiling coming down, will they escape in time and all the rest of it. It's like attempts to sort of outdo the start of Raiders in some ways.
But this is the only scene where Willie has to step up, though. It's the only essentially quote unquote Willie's moment. And it's we needed more. I mean, we'll get to a bit quite soon later on where I think they could have had a turn, like if they done it differently, they could have turned it around a bit more and make her character a bit more justifiable, more fully rounded, and a better conclusion for her rather than just standing
less shit.
Yeah, just sort of, rather than just sort of like because at one point where later on in the film where Indy's just fighting, she's literally just like stood there watching him, kind of going, "Yay, Indy, go!" It's just like,
yeah,
what, you know. At least Marion was doing something when she was there, you know. Yeah, she was always doing something. I mean, even when tied up, she was playing a part in the film, you know. So where are we up to? Yeah, so basically they escape the Crusher, and then we basically meet our lead villain, and we're kind of like an hour into the film.
Yeah, as I say, I did a time check, but he'd already been on screen for a minute or two. I called it up and it was like 1:02, and we'd already seen him, and he was talking to Indy. So we probably first see him just before the hour mark, and he speaks after just a little after.
When did we first see him? When he was talking to Indy? Which bit was that? Was that the?
Well, obviously they spot what's going on first, don't they? And then Indy goes down there. So you know, by the time that he goes down there and they are talking, it's over an hour in.
Oh, okay, yeah, got you. Sorry.
And you got the bit where he pulls out the man's heart, you know, the sacrifice, and you think, bloody hell.
And that was the bit that got cut out by the BBFC, wasn't it?
It was my memory, and again, memories can play tricks on you because you see it years afterwards and so on. My memory is that was in the version that was on the big screen. That was in the cinema. Yeah, I think, and I don't mind if listeners want to correct me if I'm wrong there, because memories aren't reliable. But I thought that was in the cinema version, and then I think might have been missing from like home video or TV.
And then came back for the DVD, really.
Quite possibly. I might be wrong on all that, but I thought I saw that the first time I saw the film.
I think you might be right. I mean, I say that without checking anything, but I think from what I understand, I think that...
Either way, it is dark for a film that has one of the three leads as a child. And
there's lots of child actors.
Yeah, it's very dark. And yeah, the effect doesn't look great now, but it looked amazing at the time. It really did.
I think it's less to do with the effects and more the idea of it, the image of it, so to speak, of literally just opening up your chest, pulling out your heart, and it's still beating. And then, I think that kind of, it's
the concept,
yes,
isn't it?
Really? Yeah, that's the one, yeah. I mean, it's always going to look a bit goofy, but then I like those kind of like goofy rubbery looking effects.
It's only really as the chest closes over. But again, in my mind, after I first saw it, he literally ripped through someone's chest and pulled it out, and it looked completely real. It's only when you revisit it, you go, well, our standards of what we have to see for it to be real, and plus I'm older.
Mm.
But yeah, this was really, really dark and hardcore at the time.
And he gets lowered into basically lava and...
It's a long time until we see daylight again as well, which is a problem I have with this film a little bit.
Yeah, we spend a lot of time underground, obviously, don't we?
Yeah. Spielberg himself has sort of complained about that when he looks back on it.
But, what can you do, though? I mean, it's just where it's set. I can't see where the chance to even do that. Maybe it was written better. But, here's one of the issues with, and I'm fine with the villain himself, because at the end of the day, he's just a crazy, religious nut job, isn't he, really? He's basically like a voodoo type sort of,
He's a cult leader, pretty much, isn't he? He's got this ancient kind of like thuggy cult that's kind of threatening to rear its head.
Yeah.
And he's just...
Coming from the shadows, so he won't necessarily be right there, but the problem is that you get introduced to him and he doesn't have much. It's not like last week where you get Balog, which is a really kind of fleshed out character, and on top of that you have a load of Nazis hamming it up, so you get more than what you need with Raiders. This is just kind of like, it's just kind of, yeah,
That's the thing, it's loosely connected scenes, Chris, because you've got Belloc teased in the first one, and then he comes back a bit later on. I'm not complaining it's not as good as Raiders of the Lost Ark. Not that many films of this type are. But we spot him, we see what he does, and then basically Indy's under his spell fairly quickly, and then it's a big chase. And you just think, well, none of that was really set up, and it's just loosely connected action.
I mean, there's nothing special about him. I mean, that's the problem. I mean, we don't get any connection as an audience. It's just like
I didn't know for years. I knew they'd taken the kids, and I knew they'd taken the stones. And the stones, they kept saying fortune and glory. Well, in this concept, actually, it means power, which isn't the same thing. Because if you were stealing it to be rich, well, have at it. Who cares? Be rich. It took quite a while to figure out what the kids were even really taken for. They were slaves, but like, why? Why are they mining? It's all there, but it's all kind of glossed over kind of quickly.
We get to the point they get captured, but they all get captured. Indy drinks the blood. There's all.
And we've got a voodoo doll in it as well. The Maharaja's in a trance.
Yeah.
Again, for years, I don't think I realised that. I just thought he changed his mind when I was a kid. But he is being controlled. He's giving Indy pain by stabbing a doll of him that they've knocked up.
He is a bad actor. I don't like being rude on child actors, but...
He's not very good.
Yeah, no. But, see, now, now we get to the point where basically they start doing the sacrifice of Willie. And it's up to Short Round to save the day. Now, here's what I think what they should have changed. They should have changed it around so maybe have Willie's the one who's not got captured, and you develop like a clear path way for her just to get out of there, and or there's a decision that she can make, which is like, right, well, you can get out and have a safe passage to civilization, whatever. But instead, she finds in herself to come back and save Indian Short Round. And I think had there been that, her character would have been a lot more justified, and I think she would have been a lot more liked as a character than what she's actually given to do here. I think what they did here was like they gave Short Round the hero moment, and yet they give Short Round another hero moment when he has to fight the
and he's
the
already had one at the start of the film. He got them out of there.
Yeah, so that, you know, it's like, look, you know, let's give Willie something. Let's give Willie that. I mean, you could have. I mean, I thought about maybe giving like having Short Round be the one who gets sacrificed, and Willie's the one who comes in and actually saves it and figures like the bit of the fire. You know, it would have given a bit of like a, you know, a brain when a brain starts working or something. You know. Yes. It was just an idea, but again, they just gave it a Short Round, and it's just like, I get it with the kids, but, you know, really needed something.
At no point in this film, the normal arc for any sort of character like this would be a moment of realization where they have to put someone else first.
Mm.
And all right, she kind of saves them when puts her hand through the bugs, but...
That's it, okay. Though.
I mean, that's kind of a... really have a fucking choice, did she? Unless you wanted to watch them fucking crushed.
That's like her whole entire arc, pretty much.
Yeah. And I just think, yeah, they it's not a great character. Kate Capshaw doesn't think it's a great character. Steven Spielberg, in hindsight, doesn't think this is a particularly good film. You know, I don't think anyone was that happy with what they ended up with. But, you know, it does lead on to pretty good set pieces. I mean, Indy nearly kills her while he's under a trance. He gets burnt by Short Round to come out of the trance, and then you go through the long... Then he gets dressed back in his uniform, and then he's... and then
it's really cheesy, that moment, you know, that whole, like, Indy, I love you, you're my best friend. You know,
I hate that.
It's, and then that whole thing
And
where...
I reckon that would have been... just knowing how shit he is with dialogue, they handed George Lucas... He didn't write the script, but the script is based on a 20-page treatment he did write. And treatments do have the odd little snippet of dialogue in there somewhere, and I bet that's George Lucas's lines.
Probably.
But it does go on to the minecart chase, which is pretty good.
Yeah, I think again, it's like it's more like the roller coaster kind of thing. We get the fight with the second fight with Pat, or the third fight really, with
Pat Roach.
Yeah, Pat Roach. Yeah.
Pat Roach. Yeah, there is. You almost certainly all know this already. But we mentioned it last week. He is the guy that Indy fights by the plane in Raiders, the bald guy.
He appears in it twice, doesn't he? Once as one of the Arab thugs, and then again as the bald guy who he fights.
Yeah.
So he's in the movie twice. Oh, no, in the Himalayas, that's it. That's where he appears, yeah. First of all.
But a lot of people do only recognise him in that second one, and yeah. I'm one of them. I've never spotted him anywhere else, even though it's probably really obvious.
Yeah. He's in the third one briefly. But
again, I don't know where.
It is blinking, you're missing, but they had filmed something more significant, but it got deleted.
I think he was a bit of a good luck charm for the series and for Spielberg. I think, you know, it's a bit like Warwick Davis in Star Wars, put him somewhere. You know.
Yeah.
Get him in there.
Well, like, the mine chase is all pretty good, but I'm just not that engaged by any of it. You know, there was a bit of a ticking clock in Raiders as well. And it was, you know, can we get there in time? Can we stop it? Eventually it proves they can't, but it's all very tense as they're going along. And whilst this film keeps moving, it's lost all momentum after they've got to Bangkok.
Yeah, it's just all action, which I don't mind. I mean, I've said it before.
It's good action. That's why I said at the start, it's a master filmmaker masterfully making a not very good film.
Yeah.
It's still really well made.
I think, yeah, I'll buy that. So here's the problem. We can't. There isn't much to talk about beyond that, because it, unless you want to talk about like how gross Pat Roach got getting crushed by the stone machine, and like the carriage.
That was always my worry with this film of the four. I mean, when we moved on from Bond, I had a slight feeling that, well, we have enough to say, but we did. I mean, we put Raiders out last week, and that was a couple of hours long. I think we won't have any problems with Last Crusade. Plenty happens in that film.
It's one of my favourite films as well, so I hope we'll have a lot to say about it.
Crystal Skull, there's plenty to say, and I don't just mean because there's a rant possibly in the offing. There is plenty to say about it. I think this film is really thin. I just think all the interest in it's in about the first quarter of an hour, and then there's a couple of gross out scenes, a bit of talking, nearly a shag, and then basically
happy ending.
A few action, no happy ending, because they had to go and do something else. But, she may have given him a happy ending after the film finished. I don't know.
All the children are returned. You know, the stones return to the
village. I hope she wasn't doing it while that was happening.
No, she wasn't, but it happened off screen.
But again, it's like they cut the whole thing with kids, and it's like, well, I've got nothing against children in the slightest, but I suppose them being in slavery makes it sad and difficult and all the rest of it. But the only kids we've had any real exposure to have been Short Round and the Maharaja. So if we're going to care about them, they're the only two.
You kind of get the sense that the Maharaja really isn't totally in power, is he? Because he's kind of like, you know, as long as I'm in charge, you know, in my kingdom, this will never happen again.
Well,
yeah, going on behind his back.
He's hypnotized,
you know,
so really it's...
He is, really, exactly. So, and he's just, he snaps out of it, and he's not a Maharaja at all.
We'll get to this when we get to Star Trek, and I think Star Wars to some degree. But there's a couple of films in the Star Trek series where the stakes are notionally higher, in the millions of lives depend on something. Yeah. But we don't meet any of those millions of people, so who cares? And then, you know, in a previous film, it might only be one ship and a couple of hundred people, but they're led by people we know. And it's the same here. The stakes are quite high in that there are clearly a lot of children there, but it's... Why would we care what happens to these children, particularly beyond... I know there's normal human decency. No one wants to see kids get hurt. But bear in mind, no. This is a work of fiction. They're not actually being hurt. So in story terms, it's like, well, I've got no investment in this at all. These are the kids from some village we saw for a couple of minutes at the start of the film. They've been introduced late in the story. We don't see much of their plight, except they look a bit like Victorian, you know, urchins. They're all urchins, a bit dirty and stuff. So the stakes are all quite kind of low.
I think that is sold more by Harrison Ford. I mean, there's a moment where back at the in the village where one of the boy actually escapes, and Indy's just literally
And when he's translating the village elder, he sells pretty well as well.
And
Harrison Ford is properly good in this.
And when he sees like it actually happening, he looks kind of, no, I have to do something. There's very much like, no, it's almost like enraged by it. Which kind of like is funny. He kind of child like throws a rock at someone's head and goes like, oh, runs away.
Personal now.
It is thin. There's not much we can really say beyond that. I mean, we get to the whole drawbridge scene, which is, you know,
great, really well done.
Yeah, I think that's quite a good scene. I think it's quite tense, and especially when literally you've got.
Hold on, lady, we're going for a wide. Sorry, that's there's my racist remark there.
You would have said, me, you live longer. You do really, really bad Short Round impression. But no, yeah, I think it's quite tense where you've literally got like.
Your cheat, that's a joke.
When I think of this film and a mental image of it, I mean, you think of Raiders, there's several, but it might be him landing in front of the Cobra. It might be him coming out of the shadows at the start of the film. There's several little things that.
The faces melting.
Yeah,
off.
When I think of this film, I think of Harrison Ford on this rope bridge. This is the
exactly.
Icon. This you could argue the mind chase, but I get bored with that. It goes on too long. This sequence is for me the iconic bit of this film.
I tend to think of this scene and also Chilled Monkey Brains, but there we are.
But I mean, the very fact that like a not very good film in relation to the rest of most of the rest of this series has a couple of fairly iconic
scenes.
Yeah, I mean, it's still well made by a filmmaker. I just think the story needed more work.
There was one part in the drawbridge bit where I kind of went, oh, that's a bit convenient why he did that, because Indy's basically cornered. He's like from both sides by both henchmen. The bad guy, I don't know his name. What?
Molaram,
yeah. I mean, that's how well developed. I don't even know what his name is. Yeah, that's not as ridiculous. I still enjoy this film, but you know, Molaram's got essentially has Short Round and Willie, like not on the drawbridge. Already like sort of outside it, and they've already got Indy cover. Like Indy threatens to throw the stones over if they don't essentially let Willie and Short Round go. And he goes like, "Well, don't matter. We'll just dig them out. We'll just find them at the bottom. It's fine." So he's like, "Shit." So, and then Indy's thinking, "Right, well, I'm gonna have to cut the drawbridge." And then for no reason, Molaram takes Willie and Short Round and himself on the drawbridge. I was like, "Why have you done that?" There's no reason for him to do that. He's already said like, "No, I'm not." Gonna
either
do that.
He'll drop it, or he'll go back the way he came and they'll be captured, yeah. Or he'll come towards you and be captured.
So there was no reason. I mean, it was just a bit of a...
Yeah, I know. But you got to get him into this
sentence. I know.
And again, I've been fairly tough on the flaws of this film when it's a series that lives on some of these things, but it doesn't really bother me. It's a pretty good sequence.
Yeah. But
and again, we've seen him rip a man's heart out, so when he puts his hand to Harrison Ford's chest... Watching it as a kid, I was like, "Oh fucking hell!"
It's quite terrifying, isn't it? I think I must say, I do. Just to go back a few steps, I do think Harrison Ford's performance, like when he sort of, as I say, in quotation marks, drinks the blood, when you see him, he's actually like transfixed and under the spell, as it were. And I still find that scene. One thing I can't abide. This sounds really stupid. One thing I can't abide in the film is like kids being hit, women being hit, and a cruelty to animals. That's three things in movies that I can't abide, apart from obviously all the other violent
elements,
things like that. No, I know it's not real, but it's just something that still shocks me.
So she watches a triple bill of this, Apocalypse Now, and Goldfinger.
God! God help me. Oh no, it's just one of these things. It's like, well, you know, I think he does a really good performance anyway. And where he kind of, you know, drinks the blood and sort of becomes brainwashed, as it were. And there's a scene, obviously, where he smacks Short Round in the face, and he seems to enjoy it, and you just think, obviously, I know it's a bit cheesy, you know, kind of got like sort of the father-son relationship between them. And think, Indy, you're my best friend. And you just think, oh. But to me, that amplifies it more. I think I find it very sweet. I mean, I'm quite emotional. But I find that relationship, quite, you know, quite sweet. So,
yeah. Can we get a bit of digital wizardry on this from somebody, and somebody cut Jake Lloyd into that scene being smacked repeatedly?
Yes. Yes, that's what you want.
Because he's not bad, this kid. I mean, I wish there weren't kids in it, but he's not bad at all.
No, he's all right. He's all right. I honestly don't know what he's done since.
He's only did Goonies, really. That's about
Goonies. That was it.
This film reminded me of Goonies because Goonies is really episodic, and I'm not remotely interested.
Can I say something that's really controversial?
You said it on a previous podcast.
I think I'm going to say the same as you.
Yeah.
Neither of us like it, Chris. Me or you?
No, I don't. I'm not. I think it's overrated. Goonies.
I think it's a flat out bad film, actually.
I'm somewhere in the middle. I mean, yeah, it's one of those iconic movies of the 80s, but it's a little bit overrated. But it's good fun. It's a good action, you know.
Try watching it when you're not a kid, though.
That's what it is.
Nostalgia for it. It's fucking awful. And the thing is, I think I said this at the time, I'm not that... Kids aren't always that interested in what kids are up to. There's nothing aspirational in that, really. You might get the odd scene, like Short Round driving the car, but like as a kid, I was watching stuff like Back to the Future, which is at least somebody playing a teenager or something. I don't care what fucking really young kids are up to.
And nearly
everyone's crap in it. Except Robert Darby, of course, who was like, you know, sexy and amazing, Chris.
Let's get him on the show at some point.
That is an odd film, because it starts with essentially like a prison breakout, and it's quite straight and adult-looking. It feels like you're watching like at least a 15 certificate film at the start of the film. You know, it's quite a serious, not like a non-kiddie film.
And there's a dick joke in it. Where they break the dick off that thing and put it on the wrong way, and it's like we'll all be pissing in each other's faces. Which is the only bit of the film I can really remember now, because that's funny.
And it has another Willie in it, King Willie.
He hasn't acted. He's not acted since 2002, and he's got a grand total of 8 different credits after The Goonies. So, and The Goonies was his second after this. 2 of those are TV shows, or 2 of them were repeating roles, and he was in Head of the Class about 5 or 6 years after this. But yeah, he didn't go on to do much in this business. I mean, it's not to say he wasn't successful doing something else.
I don't know. I'm never a fan of kid actors myself. It's like when they bring out Britain's Got Talent and X Factor, you know, when like they bring on like these kid singers, and it's and everyone goes, oh, he's adorable, and I think no, it's
exploitative
annoying.
Of adults, so it's doubly exploitative of kids.
It's not kid yourself. Yes, he's good for a 6-year-old, but come on.
But he's a 6-year-old.
Yes, you know.
It says he's now IMDb trivia now says he's a martial artist. He's working as a stunt coordinator, and it says recently. Well, this film was ages ago, so this is out of date. But it says recently worked with Jet Li on The One. Well, The One's about 15 years old.
Yeah.
But yeah, he was training people in martial arts at one point. But hey, most kid actors don't go on to be very much in acting terms. It's quite rare, and he's not the most annoying kid I've ever seen.
It is odd that because even like the actor who's played Joffrey in Game of Thrones, he says he's given up on acting.
Yeah,
and even like in the
imagine doing that must have been quite grueling for him though, because he's quite young.
Well, imagine, but it's just like you got to think these kids are like growing up doing a job, and then probably like get to a certain age where you think, well, that's not what I actually want to do anymore.
Yeah,
people like I'd say Jake Lloyd that we mentioned earlier, and people like who's Matilda? I can't remember her name.
No, I can't.
Mara Wilson. I know that sort of killed. Yeah, Mara Wilson. That's the one. Yeah, the 90s.
Oh yeah, she was everywhere then, wasn't she?
Yeah, she was. And now, I think she's in BoJack Horseman for one. But she does lots of little bit parts here and there, and you know, she does things off screen. She's more involved, you know, behind the scenes, as it were.
Jake Lloyd's been in trouble with the law, and
he's had like drug problems.
Really?
I believe he may have even been diagnosed with schizophrenia.
He went off the ropes a little bit, bless him.
Really? Yeah,
he says that it ruined his life, and you know, maybe it did. I don't want to judge him on it.
I'm just like too much, too young, maybe. I don't know.
And we forget their people sometimes when we slag them off in certain roles. I will, when we get to Star Wars, I will be reasonably tough on him. But yeah, the fact is, they cast a then 8-year-old when he was acting in it. I think he turned 9 during the production, and it's like, well, it's the filmmaker's fault for putting him there. Cast Anakin older, you know.
See, I remember him being interviewed back in the day when the Phantom Menace was getting released, and he always struck me as actually quite astute for a young kid. I mean, I'm not, you know, forget about his acting skills, you know, because I don't think you really judge acting really when you
not with kids.
Yeah, no.
And again, he's far from the worst I've ever seen. And the bits that really irritate me is him saying really something shit that shouldn't have been put in his mouth in the first.
It's the dialogue, if anything.
So he's not good, but, you know, very few child actors in terms of quality are like Haley Joel Osment.
Yeah.
There aren't many of those around.
And he's coming back.
Where is he now?
He's in stuff.
He's acting again now. He took a break.
He's in Kevin Smith films and things like that. He basically looks exactly the same, but chubbier and a bit longer hair.
Yeah, he's just basically been scaled up.
He's been working out.
I think he took a slightly defective form of the super soldier serum. I think I think like Captain America, he went in there a little kid and just came out a much bigger one.
I'm sure he still looks cute.
He doesn't, trust me. But hey, people change. I don't want to be too hard on any of these people.
No.
Jonathan Ke Quan is absolutely fine in this film. I just wish he wasn't in this film. Do you know what I mean?
He's memorable for that role. I mean, he'll forever be known a short round. And for,
yes, he will.
You know, for Goonies and things like that.
You were about to say "and four," and then you remembered you couldn't think of his character name in the Goonies.
No, I couldn't.
Which would have undermined your arguments. He'd be forever remembered
as the Chinese kid in the Goonies.
As Data. That's his name, Data. I just remembered his name. That's it.
All right. Doesn't trip off the tongue as quickly as Short Round, though. I know we've just watched it, but we would have always known that.
And the last time I saw The Goonies was probably 2004, so quite a while ago now. So.
Oh, really?
You were at college by then or something. You've been about 19.
No, I know, but I literally haven't seen it. I was trying to think, when's the last time I saw that movie? Yeah. For some reason, I think we watched it. You know, when I did an exchange to America. For some reason, we watched it there, and I was like, "Hold on a minute, that was about 2004." I'm like, "Oh my god!"
Yeah. You didn't fly to America just to watch The Goonies, did you?
No, we didn't.
I flew to Oklahoma to watch Oklahoma. Quite an uninspired choice, when I think about it.
Let's add it to our musical section.
What, all the musicals?
All the westerns.
Well, that would come in both, wouldn't it? Oklahoma.
Yeah, that covers both camps there. But I think it's got a much bigger cult following than it does in the States than it does over here, for example. But that's the reason why it didn't chip off the tongue, just because I've seen...
Yeah, but The Goonies was a cash-in on stuff like this.
Sure, exactly.
An attempt to do a kid version of it. And I know people on Twitter and people who are following, and some people who are listening to this who probably love The Goonies, and fair play to you, but you probably loved it because you saw it as a kid. It's not a very good film.
Yeah, I just didn't hold up. I mean, I just remember watching it and thinking it was just all over the place and just like, why does everyone love this film so much? But then, you know, you are right, it's nostalgia. It's like The Burbs. I think maybe I need to rewatch The Burbs, but
yeah.
I just thought that was a bit overrated for what it.
Maybe we can take that, make it into a new kind of section. Maybe take some movies like from our past or from our childhood or ones that we've liked previously, and we are seeing them again, watch them again, and think, you know, do they still stand the test of time, or do they think, ah?
Some of the films are going to be covered in different series.
Yeah, exactly.
You would include possibly some of the Star Wars films in that and so on. Well, we're doing Star Wars separately, but some of the smaller films that didn't become series, when I think of things like Big and Talking to Tom Hanks and The Money Pit and stuff like that.
I've not seen The Money Pit.
It's hilarious.
The Money Pit has two or three really funny bits in it. I don't think it's that good, but as the name suggests, he and Shelley Long are married and they buy a house and it becomes a money pit. It's in a real shit.
Everything
goes wrong. Yeah, and it actually nearly breaks them up and stuff, but there are bits of it that are funny. So yeah, Temple of Doom. That says it all about this film. We're talking about other 80s films.
I like this theory. If we get when we get stuck on a film that's quite thin on plot, we just go on a tangent about something. It'll be fine.
Just talk about other films from that era.
Yeah, just talk about other stuff, you know.
This film did very well. It took about 55 million less than Raiders. Raiders took nearly 390. This took about 330 something. And it didn't do as well, but it was still very popular. But it was the third highest grossing film in the North American box office of that year. Now, one of the number two doesn't surprise me at all. It's Ghostbusters. But the number one really does. The highest grossing film at the American box office in 1984 was Beverly Hills Cop.
I love Beverly Hills Cop.
I love it, but it's R-rated, isn't it?
Well, you know, that just goes to show, you know, R-rated to still be a bit box office smash.
I wouldn't have expected that. These days they'd have made
not it by today's standards. No, our rating is basically
this year. Deadpool. You know what I mean? I think isn't Deadpool like one of the biggest?
Yeah, but it's not the highest grossing film of the year.
What's the highest grossing film of the year? Which one is it?
Well, I don't know yet. We're not at the end of the year, are
we? Okay, well, so far
we're going to have a Star Wars film at the end of the year. We've had, I would think, Captain America: Civil War is probably the highest of grossing worldwide of the year so far. But we've still got Finding Dory to come out in this country. It's already out in America. We've got. Batman Superman is probably second to that at the moment. But
that really underperformed.
It underperformed, but it opened massive and it still grossed well. Just not as well as a film with those two characters in should. But yeah, so this film did very, very well. But it's 5 years until we see it again. It's 5 years again until we get the next one. And I don't know whether it was planned after this. I don't think I don't think the filmmakers were overly happy with what they produced here.
Yeah, I think, you know, you can kind of tell how they talk about it in the special features. You can kind of like, you just talk more about the experience, and then Spielberg goes like, yeah, and I got the girl at the end, hey, and then that's it, really.
Yeah.
It's a little bit more technical. You can kind of you kind of feel that's where the film's at, when they all start talking about, like, in depth about the technical, how they pulled off certain things rather than how they actually felt about the thing. But I think with next week and you know, spoiler alert, but it is my personal favourite indie film. It's my first cinematic experience watching an indie film. So
I saw, I mean, what I think says it all for me, they came out again, you say it was your first cinematic. It was my second, obviously, because because Temple of Doom was my first. But it had been such a long gap to this one that Last Crusade almost feels like my first.
Yeah.
But I went to see it 3 years ago when they re-released it, around the time of the Blu-rays coming out, I think. But they re-released them, each of them. I don't know if it may just have been the first three. And they were like a week or 2 weeks apart, each of them. So I went to see Raiders, loved it. And I went to see Last Crusade, and I went with a friend of mine who brought his daughter, and I worked out while we were in the car on the way there that she was the exact same age to the month that I'd been when I'd seen Last Crusade. And I just thought it was really great, and just being able to watch it through her eyes, because she was absolutely blown away by it.
Yeah.
And but one thing is, I didn't go and see Temple of Doom. I was going to, and then I couldn't be asked. And I think I stuck the Blu-ray on at home. So I did watch it, but of the three 80s films, I couldn't even be asked to get off my sofa for this one. And I do genuinely believe that if you take nostalgia out of it, or if this film is more your type of film than the other ones, but if you like Raiders and you like Last Crusade, I dare say you could almost skip this one. I don't think it's particularly essential.
Yeah, but I'd much rather skip the other one.
For me, you could easily split this film into two totally different, completely different films. And it's the divide is so big, I kind of have trouble reconciling them, to be honest. I would agree with you, Chris, definitely. Last Crusade is, for me, personal favourite. I kind of rank them in random order. I don't think I saw Crystal Skull, I think, was like the first indie film that I saw in the cinemas. I don't think I've ever seen any of them on the big screen, as far as I know. As far as I can remember, anyway.
Well, I've seen one way or another, I've seen them all that way now. Yeah.
Yeah.
Restored.
I should say, I'm looking forward to it. Obviously, I enjoyed Raiders. Raiders is huge fun. This film, I mean, not to say I still enjoyed it, but there isn't much to go on, sadly. But then, Last Crusade is probably, if not one of my all-time favourite films, if not my favourite indie movie. So I'm looking forward to that next week.
Great. So that's Temple of Doom, folks. We are moving on to, I think we would all agree, a better film next week. And I think the week after, there's just more to say about Crystal Skull, because like it or hate it, there's more there. This is just...
There's more LaBeouf for your book.
Yeah. Yeah.
And CGI monkeys and hamsters and goats. Ray and
Winston.
Gophers. Oh, yeah, Ray Winston.
I hope he's not in the next one. Not Ray Winston, he dies in four, doesn't he? But Shia LaBeouf, I hope he's not in the fifth one.
He's going to be replaced by Chris Pack.
I hope it's LaBeouf curtains.
Oh.
Take a bow, Dave.
Oh, dear, I managed to get a beef curtains joke in. All right. Becca, raise the tone by teaching us something. Do you have any fun facts?
I do, I've got five fun facts.
Wow, there's a temple in my pants! Come on, Cole, check back!
Okay, it's fun fact number one. as discussed, obviously, it's Kate Capshaw's second theatrical movie. She had to criticise her role as just a screaming dumb blonde, which is pretty much spot on. Fun fact number two, obviously, as we mentioned at the start of the movie, the writers and filmmakers were inspired by sort of the early kind of Hollywood musicals, sort of the RKO musicals, Warner Brothers and that, with the 30s and 40s. I think in particular, obviously, Gunga Din, which kind of has the same similar plot lines. Obviously, you've got British army adventurers battling against thugs, as it were, in colonial India. Obviously, the locations found for this film were found in India, but sadly enough, they couldn't shoot there. So it's mainly around Sri Lanka, and then, as we mentioned, back by Paramount and Elstree Studios. But you wouldn't know.
I wonder how it would have looked had they actually got permission to shoot in India.
But they just had to find somewhere and matte painting the hell out of it. Mm-hmm. So it might. basically, when they got to Pankot, it might have looked a bit more real because they might have found something a little bit more in keeping. I don't actually think it would have been that much different.
No, I mean, the sets are very terrifying, but it's very obvious it's a set, and as it was aware. I mean, like, the actual temple itself, I mean, it looks beautiful, but it's, you can tell it's artificial, which is a shame.
Well, I just associate, I mean, Bond, when I think of Bond, he can be in, like, a casino, or he can be anywhere. And whilst you do want to see him outside because of the locations, but I do think of, when I think of Indy, I think of, like, jungles and you know, deserts. And you know, I just think of it as a very outdoor series. So this jars a little bit.
It's all right. We can go indoors. It's fine.
It's allowed indoors. I'm not saying. What were you, born in a barn?
Not allowed indoors. But for the creepy crawly tunnel, the production used 10,000 snakes, 50,000 cockroaches, and over 30,000 beetles, which I think is pretty gross.
How many actually died from being stepped on?
Probably much more. Not very nice
much
at all.
Many
more.
Over
those figures were used. So, but yeah, double that. No, yeah, I imagine quite a few of them. Obviously, hopefully they had, you know, insect wranglers prepared, you know, behind the scenes to sort that out. So, but anyway, for the dinner scene, luckily the bugs unused in that scene were plastic. Obviously, the edible innards were made out of custard, and the same as the chilled monkey brains are actually made out of custard and raspberry sauce. So delicious. And that's my five fun facts.
Yeah, that's why monkeys just don't rule the world or anything. Their brains are made of custard and fucking
and sauce.
And sauce. Well, I think poor it's monkeys. Fair to say that's fun, folks.
Becca. Where can you find us on social media?
You can find me at ThePastyKid1976 on Twitter.
You can find me at Cinematronics on Twitter. This podcast is on my website, which is cinematronics.co.uk.
You can follow me, if you want, at RVMovies. You can find us at Expect Us To Talk. Also, have a search for us in iTunes. Vote for us, and that will make us rank higher in the searchings.
Yes, please, just give us a ranking out of five. You know, so
the high... five.
Yeah, so preferably five if you like us that much. You know, give us a good review because it does help. So we can do that on Stitcher as well. Anywhere you can sort of just help, just, you know, introduce the podcast to new people, see if they like it. If they want to hear us swear for 2 hours each week, it's fine.
Well, we're followed by Oxford University graduates and all sorts.
Yeah,
classy.
They appreciated the dry wit of my beef curtains jokes.
You can also find us on Facebook at Expect Us To Talk, and you can also email us, expectustotalk@gmail.com.
You can Gmail us at email.com.
I'm going to say that again because I said the water went down the wrong way.
Yeah, I'm leaving it in, so carry on.
expectustotalk@gmail.com. Do it now, you know you want to.
You know you want to. You know you want
to. Do it.
Do it now!
Do it now!
I fully expect next week's episode to be fucking awesome. Which means, Becca!
I fell off my chair.
You're that excited.
I fell off my chair starring Ted Danson.
The thing is, that actually sounds like it could exist.
I fell off my chair with Ted Danson, really. That was my first name into my head.
It sounds like a shit early 90s film he would have done, probably.
It does. After doing Three Men and a Baby or whatever it was.
It's going to have to be a really fucking awesome pitch, though, wouldn't it? I mean, if you went in to pitch a film called I Fell Off My Chair, you'd have to have some really fucking well thought out ideas.
It's like, how big a star was Ted Danson to be in films? Because he was in a few early 90s films. Like,
in the early 90s, he was the highest paid TV star in the world.
Really?
Yeah, because he was on Cheers.
Of course.
Yeah, but he was in things like Getting Even With Dad and things like that.
And Made in America.
Yeah. Didn't Ted Danson actually date Whoopi Goldberg?
Yeah, he did while they were making that. Then he went. Then he went off. And he's married to Mary. No, he's not. I was Mary Steenburgen.
Yeah, yeah. But I tell you who else dated Whoopi Goldberg. Dalton.
Did he?
Yeah. Apparently, briefly, obviously, but yeah. It's
Why are you suggesting he doesn't last very long?
Yeah, I don't know why I added the obviously. That was just like
irrelevant. Did he send her to the bar?
Didn't mean anything. Huh?
Did he send her to the bar?
He's ladies man. He likes short stays. You know, what can I say? All right.
Well, I'm not going to cut any of that, but we will try it again. Becca!
We will return with Last Crusade.